We love you. Come here.
Aww. You don't need to make noise. You can be quiet.
Good evening. This is the Oscar Expert here with Brother Bro. It is time for a review of Never Rarely, Sometimes Always, a film which was out in a limited release, and then the coronavirus happened and theaters shut down. You can rent it for $10 on Amazon or wherever, and it's in full HD. Crisp quality, whole HD, not 480p. High quality ultrasound audio. I saw this film at Sundance because I'm special. And so I watched it again because, you know, when you're at Sundance, you're barraged with, I was barraged with about 3 to 5 movies a day. It's a little hard to give your full investment to every movie. I actually liked it a little more. This is a movie about a 17-year-old girl who wants an abortion, and she lives in a family who's not really supportive.
She lives in a state where it's not going to be possible.
So she has to travel to New York with her cousin to get said abortion. And it's a very simple movie. It's an extremely simple plot. Like, what I said is what you will get with this movie. But, you know, it's about the experience of going through it. It's a movie that exists for empathy, trying to get the audience to understand what she's going through. Is it profound? Is it simple? Is it both? That's up for you to decide. It feels very personal, but it's also clearly a movie that addresses a controversial topic. I think it's smart how it does that in a quiet and simple way. It's not shouting like most debates that we hear. It's not really trying to have a debate. It's just,
and it's not about a character who has a revelation and then like crusades for, you know, some legislation to get passed. Like, it actually completely avoids explicit politicization.
Sure.
That of the topic by being a film where, like, the characters barely even say anything. They're barely communicating their own thoughts. So it's not a didactic approach. It's very much just showing you this journey that many people take. Criticism from people whose criticism doesn't matter and shouldn't even be, like, mentioned is like, oh, well, we're promoting something bad by just telling a story. Which is kind of like when people say, you know, having gay people in your shows and movies is promoting an agenda. But, like, gay people are real and exist. This movie is just telling a story about something that a lot of women go through. It's not often talked about, but it happens very frequently.
Yeah.
Whatever your opinion on that is, you can have your opinion on it. But in terms of style, like what kind of movie this is, it's a social realism film. This is similar to like the Dardenne brothers, what they do. This is actually similar to The Rider in a way. The lead in this film was cast from knowing the director, who just saw her music and thought like she was great for it, but had no acting experience prior. A lot of the side characters in the film feel like real. The director pays attention to details of mundane life, like riding on the bus, going through the subway station, which are like very much a part of the world that we get into.
This movie's audience is very specific, and I wouldn't go around recommending this to people who don't like real sad dramas. A lot of people are going to rent this movie and be like, didn't do nothing for me. If it's for you, you might know who you are. Maybe you've already seen it. I think this movie is a very interesting experience to go on. It's like transporting in a way. Some people might find that this is like very close to home for them. Others like myself might, you know, have not experienced such things. And this is an interesting gateway to empathizing with this person. Certain scenes do have like an emotional pull that comes out, but this movie's never going to try really hard to tug at your heartstrings. It is kind of like a cold, somber movie. I think people will feel differently. Some people might feel very little towards it, and others might feel like a lot. The protagonist, as we were saying, doesn't really speak very much. Even her relationship with her cousin who comes along this journey, you know, they're the only two that really like understand each other, basically, is what it's kind of going
for.
There's
very there's very little dialogue between them, and there's also barely any smiling in the movie. These are just choices that I just accepted as, okay, this is kind of part of like the ingredients. I can't criticize it for this doesn't have characters that smile in it, because that's like saying, you know, cake is bad because there's flour in it. It's just part of the whole thing. The movie has a despairing tone. The character is heavily burdened the whole movie. Not even a way that comes out very explicitly, but is like very kept inside. When you slowly get to realize the world they're living in, just through like a couple of things, I think that's when you really begin to empathize with like who the character is and like what makes this despair everywhere for her.
The second time I watched this, a key element in the beginning, the very beginning of the movie, shifted my perspective on what I watched later. You're opening up with a talent show. It shows like three acts where they're like having fun and they're goofing and they're dancing around. And her act is that she's actually like alone with her guitar, like trying to pour her heart out and like say something. And the song that she's singing is about like a man having power over her. Like she lives in a very different world than her peers. She doesn't live in a goofy, fun world anymore. Like, that has been stripped from her through a number of factors. That's which sad. Aren't, like, there's no, like, it is sad. You know, the first time watching it, I sort of had a complaint that I don't totally abandon. Because this is, like, somebody who she's really close with, her and her cousin, maybe people joke around a little bit, even in dark situations.
Realistically, you'd have, like, banter or something. Yeah, I think there's none of that.
That is maybe something that I miss. I think it might have felt a bit more realistic if the characters, you know, had a sort of, you know, sense of humor with each other, as I think most close people in close relationships do.
I sort of agree with that, and I was thinking the same thing, but again, I feel like that would just be a different movie.
Yeah.
And it's so part of a director's vision, I feel like, that they're not going to feel free, they're not going to feel light. I wouldn't really take that away from the film, because it really worked for me. I was surprisingly invested, like, the whole time. I'm not even really sure, like, what got me in there, because on the surface, if it was just about somebody who is getting an abortion, you know, do I find that interesting enough to like watch a whole movie about it? A lot of the movie is procedural, but there's something about that, about embracing like that procedural nature, that kind of like brought me into it. Aside from that, it did reveal things about the world and about the character in interesting ways that made it more than just an abortion drama to me. It did feel like it was saying something about society, and actually did have a certain commentary on the whole issue, which is subtle, but I think is like really at the core of the movie. We have these very young women who live in a world where men are more in control sexually, and yet they are the ones who have to like bear the burden of all of that. In control is like a light way to put it. The role that men have in their lives is destructive and abusive. Men basically hold all of like the power when it comes to these relationships they've had with them, and they abuse that power. And then so you have a character who is just a victim of like that whole process, that whole system. And then how are you gonna blame that person? Like, how are you gonna say that it's all about choices and responsibility? They shouldn't have the right to choose when they become a mother, because they didn't choose the society they live in. Oftentimes men have taken away like some of their choices, or they've made choices difficult for them. I think that's really what the movie's like getting at. I think it's just a universal thing to have like a negative sexual experience with men.
The subjective like nature of the filmmaking is really powerful, and it builds a whole world where you're in this character's perspective. How do you see like men when you're walking around? Like when you're in the city, you may get stared at, you may get hit on or whatever. You even have a character who is around their age, who he doesn't do anything like unconsensual, but he doesn't seem to pay mind to how the characters are feeling. And he sometimes like coaxes them to like, oh, you like come downtown with me, and like pressures them to do things in ways that he wouldn't view as him being a bad person. This is not a cancelable guy necessarily, but he has learned from the world around him to be this way a little bit.
Think he looks at these relationships as like transactions that he can benefit from.
Another thing about like the perspective of the movie, and sort of relating to like an argument that you might say that this movie is making, like why somebody would want to get an abortion, like the town that she lives in wouldn't be supportive of her getting an abortion. And yet, if she's walking around with a visible pregnancy, or like worse, has a child, how is she going to get treated in this town? Like, nobody is there to make that better for her. You know, you can get preached to by the abortion clinic that your baby is going to be a miracle, but when you're 17, you will get made fun of, you will get completely ridiculed. You see glimpses of how she's treated, and you can't even imagine like how she would be treated if the pregnancy had developed further. So there's like an argument against that, where we talk about how like, oh, just like have the baby, you know, it's a beautiful thing. But we don't talk about how it feels to be the person walking around and how we judge that person. I thought the end was really powerful, more powerful in the second viewing, because sort of like the ending of Invisible Man. You see that? Where, like, the only thing she wanted is to not have any of this happen at all. Like, that's it. Like, the entire journey was just, like, so that she could rest easy, like, basically, which is very sad. Also, something I was, like, more aware of in the second viewing was, like, how heroic her cousin was for her.
Yeah.
Just as somebody who's there, like the only person in the world who could possibly be there for her to understand what she's going through. Unfortunately, that partly means that like the cousin has experienced a lot of the same pain that she has. These are the only two who can like share this together. And even though they don't speak a lot, that is what they have. You leave the movie and you want to be like that person for others, I guess.
Yeah, there's something really big about the movie and like kind of the portrait it paints of this world through this young woman's eyes. It's just a really unfortunate portrait that feels real. I think it's a valuable film for that reason. If you know what kind of movie you're in for, like, I think it's really good. I found it to be powerful for me, and I was surprisingly emotionally affected by it. And I think it's, like, really solid filmmaking. I'm excited to see what the director does next. I would give this movie a solid 9 out of 10.
I'm gonna give it an 8.5. It was very quietly powerful. Maybe it's a little monotonous. Perhaps that's not even a flaw, but that's just, like,
yeah, the experience just the nature of the beast
doesn't necessarily ebb and flow in the way that maybe if it did a little bit, I would like it to have more. Thank you for watching. Thank you for subscribing.
Can't really do a pun for this video, so have a good day.